Alrighty. Thank you everyone for joining for our June. I have to double check what the month is. June for our June webinar series here for the CyberForce program. If you did not just see, we are recording this. So in the event that you do need to stop or have to leave for something, this will be recorded and placed on our website after this. For those of you who aren't aware, I'm Amanda. I am the National Lab Program Lead for the CyberForce program. Tonight, we have an awesome panel speaking to us about operational technology threat landscape. So you're not going to see much of my face, so we can get to the good stuff. But before that, I do want to make note of, again, a thank you as always to the Department of Energy's Office of Cybersecurity, Energy Security, and Emergency Response, CSER for short. You guys always hear this, along with the support from many of the other DOE offices that assist with our initiative here in the CyberForce program to make sure that you all get as much information on cybersecurity and energy as possible to help you with your growing careers. So as a reminder, for those of you that are on tonight, we are still doing raffle prizes. So if you stay till the end, you'll be able to enter into one of our raffles that we have for cyber tumblers, coffee mugs, challenge coins. We have a hoodie still, and then we have plenty of CyberForce t-shirts if you do not have one. So stay till the end and we'll tell you how to enter. Further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Steph to introduce our panelists, and I'm going to save myself off camera.
Alrighty, thank you. Hi, I'm Steph. I think you've seen me on the past couple webinars. I work with Amanda on the CyberForce program at the lab level. I'm gonna send it over to our panelists here. I know we're still waiting on Patrick to join us. But Kylie, if you want to kick us off, and then we'll throw it over to Rob. Just kind of your background, where you are currently in your organization, and yeah, if Kylie, you want to go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. Hi, all. Thanks for being here. My name is Kylie McClanahan. I'm the CTO of a company called Bastazo. Actually started as DOE-funded research at the University of Arkansas. We did tech, worked on the project for a number of years, and then did tech transfer, helping with patch management in the electric sector, particularly around the NERC SIP standards. Been doing cyber security for a while now, and happy to be here.
Awesome, thanks. I'll throw it to you, Rob.
Hi, everybody. My name is Rob King. I am the Director of Research at Run Zero, which is a cybersecurity asset management company where I get to figure out cool ways to discover devices and see how they talk on the network and figure out how to secure them. And it's great. And I've been doing cybersecurity both on the offensive and defensive sides for quite some time. That headshot is actually probably 20 years old at this point, so just, ignore it. But yeah, it's a real pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
Awesome. And like I said, well, J Patrick can jump in when he can join us. But yeah, so this webinar, we chose to do it on the operational technology threat landscape. So in the CyberForce program, generally, we always like to keep that OT aspect in there because we find that many times, IT is so heavily focused on in the security world, whereas, we still like to keep that OT aspect alive and, I have to think about those threats and whether that's security or cybersecurity. It's always good to keep up the upfront. And for those in our program, we know that we talk about the OT threats and have that in there. But for anyone joining us, either for the first time or just interested in learning more about OT, if you guys could just kind of give us your personal high level idea of what OT is and kind of that landscape.
Yeah, I'm happy to kick that off. Really, there's kind of three terms that tend to overlap a lot. So you have OT is operational technology. Typically, you can consider OT as technology that affects a physical process, right? You're opening up a breaker. You're controlling a manufacturing process. That can overlaps quite heavily with ICS or industrial control systems. Again, you're looking at machinery that's controlling something. typically in industrial processes. And that has quite a big overlap with critical infrastructure. You look at water and wastewater, you look at the energy industry, you look at even a lot of manufacturing. Really, we kind of go back to looking at something that impacts a physical process.
And so to tie on, I mean, that was a perfect explanation. I can't say much more than that, other than the terms often come up. It might be worth talking a little bit about SCADA, which comes up as well. It's another term with the awesome shirt that I noticed earlier. And that stands for supervisory control and data acquisition. So that's the part that is actually responsible for checking on the status of things and getting the reports back. For how things are going in these industrial control processes.
Exactly.
And I need that SCADA shirt.
Just curious, since a lot of our audience is, collegiate and university based, going into college, thinking back, is that something you knew you want to get into, like the OT, the SCADA, the ICS, or was that kind of something just kind of sprung upon you?
Yeah. Sure. So it mine was an accident and not. So I'll joke with people now that I was born into it. My dad worked at an electric cooperative in Arkansas. I grew up in central Arkansas for 40 years. Literally walked in the door right out of college and was like, "Hi, I would like a job, please." And then never left. So he started actually as a SCADA programmer. And so when I was, when I was like 7 or 8, you would have to drive out to the middle of nowhere, Arkansas, to check on these backup data centers or disaster recovery sites. If something tripped offline and they lost connection, he'd drive and check it out. And I thought computers were cool. I'd hop in the car. So when I started college, I did computer science and wasn't sure entirely what I was gonna do with it, but knew that was kind of my area of interest. When I finished undergrad and started grad school, there was, like I mentioned, some DOE funding that was coming into the U of A to look at cybersecurity for electric power systems. Certainly, it was something I already had a passing familiarity with, and it was kind of a perfect storm of things. And really, it's a fairly small community of people who do this, and they've really have been wonderful. So I wouldn't have it, I wouldn't have an anticipated it. But I do really enjoy it.
Awesome.
And yeah, I came in from the IT security side. I was working at a company back in 2005 or so, and they said we should probably also consider industrial security and securing SCADA. And I was like, what is SCADA? I've never even heard of this, and they're like, oh, well, if you do it wrong, things break in a really bad way. And so we got to be very, very careful because we would do these security signatures. We'd block network traffic and we'd do things. And then you only knock a you only shut down a factory production line once before you learn that you have to be really, really careful when you're doing these things.
That's the truth.
Awesome. And I just want to open up to the audience as well that feel free to throw any questions you'd like throughout the webinar in the chat, and we'll definitely hit on those throughout. I'll keep my eye on that. So, in your opinion, do you think that OT is getting kind of the security attention it needs as everything is getting more, IT focused, everything's more connected, especially in critical infrastructure? Or do you think there's still quite a ways to go there?
I think that it's getting, sorry if I can jump in.
No,
I think
please.
it's getting more attention now than it has. I'm seeing it have more attention now than it has ever before, which is fantastic. And I think a large part of that is due to there's an increasing convergence between IT and OT, where a lot of OT devices are now, connected to IP speaking networks. Standard, using standard protocols. They might layer their classic protocols on top of it, but they're increasingly more integrated and under a CISO's purview. So more focus and also more accessibility. These devices are also easier to access and potentially easier to attack.
Right.
Yeah, I'll add to that. I think this partially, certainly not in entirely, but it was part is partially due to COVID, is that all of a sudden there was, there was already an increasing need for or desire for remote access to some of these, critical devices. And then all of a sudden you had to keep operating the power grid. You had to keep doing water and wastewater treatment. And some of those choices had to happen very, very quickly about how you were going to get remote access. So there's certainly an effect to go there. I think Rob, I think you're entirely right. I think this is certainly the most focus that we've seen on OT devices. I think in a lot of places you start to have a gap in the capacity to handle all of the threats, particularly when you're looking at, again, I work in the electric sector. Most of the US by area is covered by electric cooperatives. Cooperatives are owned by their members. So the people, like you as a house getting electricity, you own part of the electric cooperative. And typically you're looking at very small staffs. You're looking at countable on two hands. Number of people who are working on computer security or o usually typically IT and OT security is one person. And I think there is a real question of what is the best way for them to handle the absolute deluge of information that they get. Because certainly everyone wants to focus on it at, and rightfully so. But how do you handle that and how do you prioritize?
It's difficult even for people with large staffs. I mean,
Oh,
it's.
yeah, yes.
And do you think this is something where, like, regulations, and I know we talk about NERC-CIP and things like that. Do you think those are how easily are those to implement into this kind of OT landscape?
Yeah. I'll say NERC-CIP is not the easiest. It does. There are so NERC-CIP, for anybody unfamiliar, right? NERC is the North American Electric Reliability Corporation. It has authority to implement standards from FERC. So you have FERC and NERC. It's very fun. FERC is the federal agency, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, in So there's a set of standards governing cybersecurity in the electric sector. You classify your system as high, medium, or low impact. So basically, if something happens to your part of the electric grid, how big of an impact would it have on the rest of the grid? Because everything's interconnected. And so at the low end, you don't have to do as much. At the high end, you have to do absolutely a ton. And so there's a lot to be said. I would, if Patrick were on, I'd give him grief. He was the first SIP auditor, and has been a part of the SIP standards since the idea of them was first floated. But I will say, if you look at the electric sector kind of as a baseline compared to water and wastewater, oil and natural gas, the electric sector is better positioned, because of the regulation. There's absolutely pains in that process, in writing, in implementing, in auditing. There's across the board. But, especially looking back retroactively at the past, 10 or almost 20 years, they have absolutely strengthened the sector as a whole.
I can't add any more to that. That was brilliant. So, thank you.
My coworkers joke that any conversation with me turns into the history of the electric grid. So I'll try to keep that from happening tonight.
No, that's great. Yeah, but
Super.
I we're gonna get into retro computing if I keep talking. So yeah,
Yeah.
well.
Perfect. And then in your positions, kind of where you are at your organizations now, do you personally deal with any like compliance, at your level, or is that more different offices that are implementing that?
So with us, we our company makes tools that would be used to augment compliance. So we are we're involved at that layer of, you know, how can we help you and your corporation, your cooperative, your industry reach or ensure compliance with these regulations. But we are not involved in the writing of the regulations, nor should we be, because I would not be good at that.
And we're much this the same. A lot of things in what Vistazo does are intended to be used as part of a compliance program. It's especially with some of the reporting. So it's no good doing the things. Well, I mean, from a cybersecurity perspective, yes, do them even if you can't prove that you did them with audit evidence. But from an auditor perspective, if you can't prove that you did it, you might as well not have done it. But we don't we're not involved in any of the writing for SIP specifically. The requirements are written by the electric utilities. It's a collaborative group process.
All righty. And then, you know, looking back, I watched some of your old webinars and your old, podcasts, individually. And I know you guys talk about like the vulnerability management, patch management. If you wanted to speak on any of that, I know you had podcasts about those. So, if you'd like to speak about any of that in the OT field.
So something that we've found that's interesting is that's still a, for lack of a better term, it's not as mature as like the IT vulnerability management world. It's still something where a lot of security staff might not know about even what the vulnerability landscape looks like. There's not necessarily as easily accessible as off the shelf vulnerability scanners available for OT devices. And a lot of the ones that are out there that you might go to that were originally designed for OT will potentially cause major problems, or for IT will eventually cause major problems for OT devices if you use them. It can be a little hairy. And but there is we are seeing a significant boom. CISA, the Cybersecurity Infrastructure Security Administration, does actually publish vulnerability announcements and advisories on OT devices, and they're getting much broader or much more specific and much broader simultaneously in the vulnerabilities that they cover, which is really useful.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think CISA does a great job. Like one of the things about OT that starts to look a little bit different from an IT perspective is that you're more likely to have a focus on outages or on downtime. You can't, you know, like if you're going to patch your laptop, if you're going to update your laptop, it may require you to restart it. Honestly, a lot of the times now it doesn't. They'll install and it won't require a restart. It depends on what's being patched. You're not going to do that in OT. And really just rebooting a controller, if something is controlling a major piece of you know your wastewater treatment facility, you're not just going to turn that off. You're going to have impacts to reliability, and that's a huge deal. So you're typically going to wait until some sort of outage cycle when you are planning to say, we have to shut down our plant for a week, 2 weeks, however long it is. It's you schedule in advance, you let every other utility around you know that it's going to happen. So they know, especially in the electric sector, they kind of pick up the slack. You may bring people on site for like if you have a Siemens device, you may bring people from Siemens and you're going to do physical maintenance because there's things you have to do to make sure that, you know, things are clean, things are working properly, they're calibrated, all of that. And that's typically a window that you're going to get to patch the software or the firmware on one of these devices. And so a lot of the work becomes, what do we do in the meantime? You know, we can't patch for 6 or 7 or 8 months. What do we need in the meantime where we could tell if we were exploited, if we can tell if something happened. And then when we get to that outage cycle, we'll tackle the patches that we need to apply.
Yeah, that's when that's when defense in depth becomes so important, you know, actually having network segmentation, firewalls, ACLs, least privilege, all that. It's really critical when, as Kylie was saying, you can't necessarily patch. I mean, we'll do inventory of OT devices, and they'll be running firmware that's, months or years old, and by design, right? Like that's the nature of the beast.
And we have a question from the audience that says, as far as remote management of OT goes, how are these typically accessible from the internet? And is there a best practice for making OT accessible from the internet?
Best, there's regulatory requirements, and I don't want anybody to think that I'm speaking with any sort of regulatory authority, because I absolutely am not. But in my personal opinion, best practice is don't. But definitely make sure it's behind firewalls, behind also, as much security infrastructure as you can possibly get. And we've noticed that the number of OT devices actually exposed to the internet, individual OT devices actually exposed to the internet is holding relatively steady. It's actually going down in the United States, but it's that's being made up for by other countries putting more and more devices on the internet.
And what you an archi I'll say an architecture you may see again, I'm not not going to tell you this, but is that you may have VPN into a DMZ, kind of a gap network, if you will, between your corporate network where you have all of your email and your finance stuff and et cetera, and between any OT or operational network. And so you may VPN get access to a device in the DMZ, like a jump host, and then there have some sort of access if you need to remotely look at OT devices. Certainly, there's a lot of configuration in that that becomes really important. But at you know a VPN is becomes an you need you should have a VPN. You should not be able to pull up a terminal on your laptop and type ping at an IP address and hit your OT devices. I don't know if any of you have ever played around with Shodan. I think at one point their tagline was like the Google for the Internet of Things or something like that. You can go look at, they've actually locked a lot of it down for good safety reasons, but you could go search at, type of manufacturer. You can see cameras that people have put at their homes, just like the smart home cameras that are just on an open IP. There's if you ever need just a reality check about how scary things can be, Shodan is for that. But yeah, certainly like VPNs, no public IPs, have a separate credentials. Your credentials to get to the jump host should be different from the ones you use to get into the OT network. Best practices kind of stuff.
Thanks, Mike, for that question. And then kind of looking at going farther down that line, what does kind of the future of automation in OT look like? Or if it's already happening, how that's being implemented.
Automation in
Automation.
general or automation with like
Or like,
patch things?
yeah, like, well, either way, that you want to approach that.
Rob, do you want
So,
to
well,
go?
sure. I don't know how great my answer is going to be, because there's definitely, we are seeing a maturity in management software and management tools for these sorts of things that we didn't necessarily see before. There's a lot more and a lot more mature systems to manage a broad diversity of OT devices from different manufacturers and whatever. There's still plenty of custom specific stuff, but it's becoming much easier to do that and at least get information about your system so you know what needs to be patched, what needs to be updated, what can be automated, what can't. And with this continuing adoption of more IT-oriented protocols and things like that, you're getting an ease of management that wasn't necessarily there a decade ago. So.
Right.
Yeah, I would say certainly there's more automation with the vulnerability and patch side, there's more manufacturers are providing advisory information in a machine readable way. That's been a huge thing. When you look at a lot of the OT devices, and Rob, you mentioned CISA, right? They'll, they may publish an advisory that'll say these products are affected. This, here's what we're going to update to. Here's a description of the problem. And that those become important to operators because, like was mentioned earlier, you can't always scan OT devices in the same way you would scan IT ones to say, hey, what version are you running? Can we find out if you're vulnerable? In a lot of cases, because if you run an nmap scan and you go ping all of these IPs, you will trip devices offline. They're expecting a certain amount of traffic at certain intervals to communicate with other devices, and they will just kind of throw a fit and shut down. So when these advisories from operators become very I'm sorry, from manufacturers become very important when you're looking at what you need to do. And without them being provided in a machine readable way in JSON, there's a standard called CSAF, the Common Security Advisory Framework. That's a standard to provide this data. It is without that machine readable piece, you really can't automate a whole lot. Because how are you going to ingest information? I have written parsers and scrapers, and it is a nightmare, and I don't enjoy it. I'll do it, but I don't like it. That machine readable piece really offers so much more. We've seen like I've seen so many utilities with spreadsheets because that's the best that you have. You have a spreadsheet. You have your list of assets. Here's what you need to check for. Here's the URL. It's www.dell.com, right? And you're doing the same product lookup, and really getting out of spreadsheets into tools that allow for more automation becomes really important.
I do have to ask myself how much of my life has been spent writing parsers and scrapers, because it's
Oh,
a
goodness
large
gracious.
amount.
So much. So much of my life.
Oh. Then I mean, you mentioned things about vendors and stuff. What are some of the challenges of kind of managing the diversity of the OT devices that, say like one water treatment plant has?
Okay, so I was actually this very recently. This is like within a vendor. I was at VulnCon, like vulnerability con. It's the first one they did. It was in March, I think. It was phenomenal, like a ton of people doing vulnerability research. Some people who are, third party or individual like vulnerability hunters, people who run these kind of bug bounty programs. It was a great time. But I was talking to someone from Siemens, and we were talking about this: how do you get data? How do you do advisories? How do you? And he was saying, even within, this is not me hating on Siemens. They do a great job. They provide a lot of good data. They're also huge and international. He said, trying to get consistent naming between marketing teams, between product development teams, and between the security teams is so difficult. And so, he said sometimes people will contact their cybersecurity team and say, hey, I saw you guys release this advisory. Is my device vulnerable? They're like, what is your device called? And they'll say it. And he's like, I have no idea what that is. Like, he has to go talk to all of these different groups within the company to figure out, okay, so that was the, Supply NICS 12. I had no idea. But marketing called it the Supply NICS Pro in this region because of this market research, right? Things change, things adapted. It's really hard to keep track of that. And so even if you individually, even if you as a utility can determine what devices you have, it then becomes difficult to say, okay, well then what does the manufacturer call this? And what else might they call this same device? Software
We
naming is
have
hard everywhere, but go ahead.
Siemens has one of their protocols that they use for control and discovery is called S7, which is unrelated to SS7, which is a phone thing. And you can ask a device to say, what are you? And the device will respond to this S7 message and say, I'm a whatever. And that internal model number thing that it returns has no relation whatsoever to anything a human would ever actually know. And so you have to go and look up, I maintain this huge, essentially spreadsheet of these internal Siemens model numbers that correspond to what, would actually be printed on the box. It's fun. I'm a lot of fun at parties.
Yeah.
All right, we have another audience question. It says, considering the integration of electric power grid with IoT, what are the current trends and possible vulnerabilities in terms of cybersecurity?
A lot.
Yeah.
We're seeing, yeah. Cyber warfare and attacks on infrastructure are increasing more than I've seen in a long time. It's really, really bad. So, and we.
I'm so sorry, please keep going.
No, please go ahead, please.
I'll mention one piece, which is smart meters. So you have a meter on your home to measure electricity or water or whatever. Smart meters are just the general term for like a new generation of these devices that have more accessibility, more tools for, data analysis. What are the trends in data usage, right? Things like that. That's great, phenomenal. Let's analyze some data. Let's learn some cool things. However, we have now put a chip in it. We put more chips in it, and we've now given it an internet connection to send that data back to like a SCADA system, or if not a SCADA system, then a data gathering system. Those become millions of individual devices that then could be compromised. Now, there are some ways to mitigate that. If you look at doing asset management, let's look at what our smart meters need as opposed to each individual one. Again, you get back to a capacity and our resources. Do we have the resources to do something like that? And so, like, I'm not gonna come here and be doom and gloom. Your home will get hacked tomorrow. But with the more ability we have to look at data trends, which is great, the greater attack surface we have, and we have to be mindful of that.
Attack surfaces, yeah, that's the key phrase. The attack surface is exponentially larger than it was even just a few years ago.
All right, we have a couple questions. This next one says, in terms of OT vulnerability assessments, what are the common tools used?
I see a lot of Nessus.
Yeah.
I'm start naming vendors. Really, at least from what I see, it's more things that are more ad hoc things. It's like I know a utility that uses WinAudit. It's a tool that's been around forever. You run it on a Windows system, it gives you this whole printout of what's running, what patches have you installed, what ports are open, things like that. And then they compare that list against the advisories that they see. So there's not really, they don't have an automated system to say, this gets me straight to a vulnerability piece. Occasionally you'll see some Nmap in a very, or netstat in very controlled, locked down ways, so we don't take devices offline. But I see a whole lot more things used, like tools used ad hoc that you may already be familiar with, just to use in a very careful way.
We have seen some vendors, some traditionally IT focused vendors switching and creating OT offerings. And it's interesting to see that growth because there's a lot of them will publish, these are the OT protocols we support, and these are, the how safe we consider ourselves to be. And it's really interesting to watch this sort of cold war between the IT vendors and who's considered the best. It's gonna be a completely different world in a couple of years, I think. OT is gonna be a lot more.
I think absolutely. I think some of the larger IT companies have started realizing how big of a market has been left unaddressed. there's a different talk about financial incentives. There's all kinds of that. But I think there is almost like an arms race to see who can make their OT offerings work first. Sometimes they do it badly, and we all kind of point and laugh at them a little bit. And sometimes they get their foot in the door, and we'll see where it goes.
I just like writing protocol parsers, so that makes me happy.
And then kind of following along with the vulnerability idea, do you think that, people themselves, like going in the future, as OT isn't really taught in the curriculum as much or at university levels, do we see that people could be a vulnerability, not having the workforce?
It's definitely not, you can't go to, and I'm revealing my age here, you can't go to, Best Buy and buy a PLC. So there is a barrier to entry into this. It's a lot harder to be a hobbyist in the OT security space than it is to be a hobbyist in the IT security space. There now, that being said, there have been an immense number of boot camps and college level classes that are starting to be offered. And I think it was Siemens has even started offering relatively low cost sort of hobbyist kits that I so I right now, yes, I think there is definitely going to be a personnel shortage and expertise maybe gap compared to just people who get into IT because computers are more accessible and whatever. But I do think it's going to close. I do think it's going to close. Sorry, I just kind of jumped and ran with that. Sorry.
No, you're totally fine. Yeah. No, I mean I think there's always going to be a question of where is the next generation of workforce going to come from. I've been hearing some form of that for most of the past decade. It doesn't mean the problem's not real. I think it absolutely is. I do think there's a lot more programs starting to be offered at 2-year colleges, and technical degrees. Actually, ne next week, there's a part of a workshop to start to design one. The INL has a program that's a focus on CIE, cyber informed engineering. That's how do we if we're going to look at engineering, not just coding. There's just secure coding. That's another piece. But if we're going to look at training technicians, training engineers, training plant generation staff. How do we make cybersecurity part of that education, so that we don't have operators who, just because it was never taught to them, don't know basics of cybersecurity. And I'm talking past phishing. Like we're past phishing training. We're into you have to have some awareness of a network. You have to know what a firewall is. You have to be able to know the basics of what not to do. Don't go buy a random firewall from Walmart if your hardened Cisco firewall decides to give up one day, right? If you're not aware that firewall A does not equal firewall B, that may seem like a good solution. It may seem like the best way to protect your network. Someone with more cybersecurity experience would say, absolutely don't do that. But they truly didn't know any better, right? Like, and so it's not throwing people under the bus. It's not saying, oh, well, look at all these people who don't know any. Like, it's trying to figure out how to fit that education in a curriculum or in a training, to help the system as a whole.
Yeah, it's great to hear that that's being offered. We got a few more questions coming in. This one is about AI. How do you leverage AI tools to automate and find vulnerabilities?
Okay, I'll take this one. Like, I think this is where the distinction between AI and machine learning and large language models becomes very important. So like the project that became Bastazo was about using decision trees. Right, familiar with decision trees? It's a machine learning model. We're taking data, we're making a predictive model to say, like, can we track features of the vulnerability and features of an asset to predict priority. So like if the CVSS score is above an 8, if the device has a high level of external accessibility, right? We should handle this one immediately. We shouldn't wait until our outage. We should make an exception, right? Using something like machine learning, that can become a prioritization tool. We know the vulnerabilities. Let's figure out how soon we should deal with them. When you look at, I mean, are we going to be at a point where you say, "Hey, ChatGPT, how can I get into my local water utility?" I don't think that that's, you know, there's a lot of stuff about the capabilities of LLMs that sound very scary. There are some serious concerns to consider. I don't think we're going to get to a point where you say, "Please tell me how to hack into XX, you know, XY County, water, waste water." I think you get a little bit disconnected. You're talking about AI to find vulnerability as opposed to remediate or to look for anomalies or to, these are things that we know that machine learning and some AI approaches can do well, and can do consistently, as opposed to, we're not going to stick an autonomous agent out on the network and let it go probe things as it sees fit.
The generative AI has become such that it's almost become synonymous with AI now. But yes, things like decision trees, expert systems, rules-based detection is vital, and kind of, it's not falling by the wayside, but it definitely has doesn't have the luster that some of the newer technology has.
And I'll tie this back into to the compliance and to the regulation. These rule-based things, particularly like decision trees, give you a reason as part of it. You can trace through the tree and look at the path that it took. If you put in your audit evidence, "Didn't patch because AI told me not to," that's not going to cut it. They're not going to be okay with that. And so the adoption in OT and in critical infrastructure will be slower than IT when it comes around to IT. And in large part because of that compliance reason, you're going to have to demonstrate what you did and why you did it.
Brilliant. Yep.
All right, I'll move right along to the next question so we get through them. Do you see ICS and SCADA systems moving to a model of integrated management capability within the system?
They're getting smarter all the time. So yes, but there's always going to be a centralized, system to do the management. If I'm understanding the question correctly. And maybe I'm not.
Yeah, I think I no I think Rob, at least you and I are on the same page. I think absolutely things are getting smarter all the time. I think there's also a recognition of the redundancies built into the system, and that even like when we're going to have a failover, we don't want the failover to be on the same, power supply, even in some cases, as the main, because if our main system has failed, we want to make sure that backup is going to work. Now, where exactly the lines get drawn becomes more of an individual case-by-case decision based on what the vendor can do and what your system can do. But I do think there is an awareness that we can't have everything all in one, because then we have a single point of failure and we have redundancies to avoid that.
We are seeing more and more self-healing sounds so much cooler than it is, but yeah, the devices are getting better at, dealing with problems more or less autonomously and letting, the human operators know, hey, by the way, there's this issue, but I'm able to compensate by doing this, but by the way, you should probably fix it.
Yeah. And I think also a willingness to fail loudly. Like, if the system has a failure, we're not just going to wait until you notice that the graph isn't updating. We're going to yell at you. You know, the everything that led to the SIP standards, it was a a blackout in 2003. It was a hot day, a transmission line, right? Things expand, it gets hot, it sags, hits a tree, and there's a short. No, there's a lot of things. A lot of things happened at once, so I'm oversimplifying, right? But there was a race condition in the monitoring software, and the operator didn't see it because the race condition didn't show the alarm. The other people are calling this control center saying, "Hey, I think there's a really big problem." They were like, "It's my screen. It's not, your system might be a problem." Again, a lot of factors going in, but that's kind of the gist of it. But you see more now a tendency to say, "Hey, something's not working. Here's your klaxon." Because you're not seeing, this doesn't mean that everything's fine. It could mean that something else has failed and that display's not updating.
Yeah, a lot of defense and alert in depth,
Yes.
and it's not just the devices even saying that, something's wrong. There's even just stronger active monitoring, watchdog timers, all sorts of things. There's more monitoring systems in play.
Right. If you ever get the chance to go into a control room, particularly for like a generation facility, I mean, it feels overwhelming. They're like, there'll be like 24 monitors on the wall, all lined up, so it's one huge screen, right? And an operator will have like eight. You're like, how could you possibly manage all of this? And the answer is, you do. I mean, shifts, right? No, you have to be careful to not have overload. But it is really cool to start seeing like how much we can do, and how much information can be provided.
Important to avoid overload for the people and the systems. But a little bit of a pun there.
Alert fatigue's a real thing. Alert fatigue's a real thing. If you show somebody an alert all day, every day, they will stop paying attention to it. That it's in the, true in the medical field, it's true in OT. It's true everywhere, but like that's,
More critical in medical and OT.
Yeah, you get closer to like people's lives.
All right. And then this next one says, for newer OT devices, do they typically come insecure from manufacturers like IT devices do, such as like every device coming out of the box as an admin password and username? Do we see something similar with OT?
In some cases, having a default username and password was a step up. Where thankfully, we're getting like things have gotten a lot better. But I not to laugh at the question, but I do have to point out that like they're like, getting authentication on OT devices was a huge point. What I do see is security features do not always come enabled by default. And many times it is an extra fee to get them, before even enabling them, to have them included. That's been CISA has a secure by design push, getting manufacturers to try and write better software and make better things. One of their secure by design principles that they're really pushing hard on, and I agree, is that security features should not be an extra surcharge. That should come in the price of the device.
Yeah, a lot of these devices didn't have any security whatsoever for decades because it was kind of assumed that if you had access to this device, you were authorized to use it. You were, if you even knew where it was and how to get to it, that's why it's there. And then a lot of times also these devices tend to be relatively, in terms of computational power, relatively not super strong. And so there's not always the ability to run strong cryptographic primitives and things like that. You can't, it's things you might be sending a lot of stuff in plain text. You might not be cryptographically verifying things. That's getting significantly better. But yes, as Kylie was saying, just even having authentication at all was, or authentication that you can even like change the password if you want to be
Oh
fancy.
yeah. And I think part of this came with the understanding that security by obscurity was not good enough. Like when you talk about physical security, we're talking about like someone breaking into your warehouse or whatever. There's an aspect where you consider like how far are we? Are we in the middle of the woods? No, there's not a road here. There's a dirt path. You consider that it would take time and effort for someone to come evaluate how they would get in. And so there was a similar kind of attitude with, if you know where this device is, you know its IP, you must be authorized, because how on earth would anyone find it? IPs, there's so many combinations. And that's not the case, right? Writing a Python script to just cycle through IPs is trivial to do. And so it's not a question of, like, certainly attacks can happen that have a lot of research and intent behind them, or at least attempts to exploit that have a lot of intent behind them. It's also really easy just to take a stab at random and to hit something.
And that kind of ties into, we have time for like one, two more questions. I'll finish the last two questions in chat. This one goes, looking at exploits, it says, do you see any exploit attempts on vulnerabilities on T, and how advanced are they in their exploitations?
We do, and we've started to see these vulnerabilities added to vulnerability toolkits and exploit toolkits. So they're built in now. So script kiddies, to not to use the turn of phrase, can easily at least try them out now, and are there for reading and an analysis.
Yeah. I would say the level of sophistication does, I mean, it's going to depend. And the attempts to exploit. But I think some of the scariest ones aren't necessarily just limited to OT. The things with Ivanti. Certainly, there was a lot of infrastructure that had Ivanti devices. There's a lot of government that had Ivanti devices, all of which were affected, and also IT as well. There was one Cisco published recently that was their Talos, their threat hunting division, Arcane Door, that was perimeter network devices. Again, you're going to see those across sectors. Then you start looking at impact. You're going to have a different impact on a financial institution than you're going to have on critical infrastructure, but the underlying exploit is the same.
And it's that's where that convergence of IT and OT becomes such an interesting thing, because once you get past the gates, and into this, once you are inside the secure perimeter, it becomes a lot easier to, perform horizontal movement and get into the OT network.
And you don't see, like, one thing about traffic and horizontal movement, is that traffic between OT devices, particularly when some of these vendor-specific protocols, is typically not encrypted. Adding encryption has a time cost. It takes time to encrypt and then to decrypt it on the other side. And typically, you're looking at, I mean, the closest to real-time operations you can get. Right, we're looking at very short time frames, and so you do rely on the defense in depth, on your perimeter security, on detection within the networks to catch this, because if an attacker gets inside, there's a lot of stuff that they can read straight from the packets, and that's not necessarily going to change soon.
All right, I'll wrap it up. We'll leave it with this last question. How does someone get more knowledge? So, do you have any training recommendations, other than SANS they put, or websites for learning more about, topics in OT?
I honestly typically will recommend CISA's ICS. It's CISA and INL. There's kind of a joint. You go to CISA's website. They have some training. It's a really good kind of first in introduction, particularly if you're, like, looking for things to go more in depth in. You can get kind of an overview and be like, oh, I don't know what that is. I can go Google that. I can't just Google ICS, first of all, because you're going to get conflicting acronyms. But, like, it's overwhelming, even if you just start Googling industrial control systems. But if you start saying, I want to look at protocols. Oh, Modbus. I'll go look at Modbus. Then you can find, Oh, well, this guy wrote a cool blog. I can go read this blog, or I can go look at this, these videos. I love Grady Hillhouse, Practical Engineering on YouTube, has one of the best overviews of the electric grid I have ever seen. It's just in a playlist. He does videos about all about critical infrastructure. Find me, message me on LinkedIn. I have PowerPoints. I mean, like, truly, like, I can't tell you how much I've learned just by reaching out to people and asking them questions.
And like I was saying, I'm a lot of fun at parties. I like reading the protocol standards and specifications for these things, and a lot of them are freely available. And you'll learn they tend to be, because they tend to be older, and they tend to be having to deal with lots of different things that dealing with different physical media and things like that. They tend to be simultaneously very simple and then also quite complicated in other ways, and it gives you an idea of sort of the problems that you're dealing with in these devices and what they're having to deal with from a design perspective. It's actually really fascinating if you're into that sort of thing.
Awesome. I'm going to throw it back over to Amanda, but we want to thank Kylie and Rob so much for spending their Wednesday evening with us. It's been great. I've seen a lot of great comments in the chat about your discussion point. So we thank you so much for joining us. And I'll throw it back to Amanda.
Thank you. And thank you guys for chatting with us. We'll have to follow up back up with Patrick and give him a hard time. But for a quick announcement, and then I will let you all know how to get into the raffle because I know that's what you're waiting on. For those of you that are college students, or maybe you're interested in an early career, Conquer the Hill Rain is coming up here on July 13th. That is a Saturday. Those of you that don't know what that is our 2D dungeon crawler escape room. So you'll be doing tons of different cyber challenges, critical thinking, computer science, mathematics, encryption, the like. You have to help dude figure his way out through several different areas. There will be a 3D portion of it as well this year. So take a look at that. You can register on the website all the way through the end of this month. September 12th is our Collegiate Early Career Virtual Career Fair. That is a Thursday this year. So more information to come on that, whether you are a company looking for internships, early career, full-time, part-time, whether not, or if you are one of those people in a category of college students or early career that's 2 years or less of experience, we will send out more information. And then the capstone of everything for us here at Cyberforce is our Cyberforce competition that is in person on November 8th and 9th this year, back at in St. Charles at the Q Center. So save the date. So I know everyone's waiting anxiously, and how do you get information? And I think I just realized now I didn't even share that screen. So you guys are probably all wondering what am I talking to and pointing at. So I'm going to share the screen now. But for those of you that are looking for how to get into the raffle, in the chat, put your email and we will, that means when I say we, it's Amanda, me, myself, and I. Tomorrow morning, I will do a randomizer of selecting out the raffle prizes and I will email you. If you do not respond back to me within 24 hours, I move on. So send me an email that you actually check. Please don't send me one that you never check and hope for the best. So in the chat, your email, and I will do all of it tomorrow. I'll send you a note, respond back to me. Set one, I can let you know what you won and get an address for you, and we'll get it shipped out. Again, thank you all for spending the evening with us, and thank you to our speakers again. And we hope you guys all enjoy, hopefully, a warm summer evening, and we'll talk to you guys all soon. Thank you.
Thanks so much, guys. Have a good
Thanks, y'all.
one.